Hey, what's up, everyone? My name is Laura, and I'm really into Pokemon and also reading. And I thought today would be a really good day to combine my shared interests and see how many shiny Pokemon I can find in the amount of time it takes me to listen to the audiobook for the Diamond Eye. And I'm doing this for a couple reasons. The first is I'm feeling particularly unmotivated to read right now. So I figured giving myself a little challenge would increase my interest. And while it is okay to not want to read, that is a perfectly acceptable feeling. This is my book club book that I need to read by Sunday. It is currently Tuesday. The audiobook is about 13 hours, so that all feels very doable. The other reason is that I tend to enjoy Kate Quinn more as an audiobook than reading with my eyes. She is a really good narrator, and historical fiction, as much as I enjoy it, tends to be a slower read for me, so an audiobook really kind of helps that. I tend to listen to my audiobooks around 1.5. However, I know, because my friend just read this, that this one has a Russian accent, or presumably a character with a Russian accent, so that may slow down my audio. However, 13 hours over the course of the next, 6 days, that's very doable. The other thing is that the new Zelda game comes out on Friday, so I'm kind of hoping to get through this before then because I cannot play Zelda and listen to an audiobook, but I can shiny hunt for Pokemon. Now, if you are unfamiliar with shiny hunting in Pokemon, that would probably mean that you're just not a fan of Pokemon, because at this point I feel like shiny hunting in Pokemon is a pretty well-known activity for fans of the series. But if you're unfamiliar, shiny Pokemon are Pokemon that have a different color palette and used to be incredibly rare. I believe the original odds when they came out in the second generation were about 1 in 8,000, give or take. In generation 6, maybe 5, I'm not completely sure, those odds jumped up to 1 in 4,000, like 26. And once they realized that the community really enjoyed hunting for shiny Pokemon, they started implementing ways to make that easier. But you had to go through a lot of work to get to that point. So one of the main requirements was, once you completed the entire in-game Pokedex, you would get what's called the Shiny Charm, which would take your odds down to, I want to say, 1 in 512, if I'm remembering correctly. But if I'm not, I will put a correction on the screen of what the actual odds are with just the Shiny Charm. But there are also additional ways to boost your odds. What we're going to be doing in the easiest way is what we call, I guess, sandwich hunting and or outbreak hunting in Pokemon Scarlet and Violet. And what you do is you make a sandwich. This all sounds so weird if you don't play the games. But you make a sandwich that will increase the odds of a specific type of Pokemon to be shiny. And there are 18 types of Pokemon, I think: fire, water, flying, rock, grass, all of, that's what I mean when I say types. So between sandwich hunting and outbreak hunting, and the fact that in Pokemon Scarlet and Violet, the Pokemon are shiny in the overworld, hunting has never been easier. And this is coming off of me just doing it was over a week. It might have been closer to 2 weeks. I was shiny hunting for a Kangaskhan, and that took me 1,222 eggs using the Masuda method to find that Pokemon. And in case you're wondering, the for sure odds of Masuda hunting with the shiny charm is 1 in 512. I was over double odds, and I was not happy. That thing took a lot of my sanity. However, I just found it, and because I was about to make this video, which is going to happen first, me finding the shiny Kangaskhan or me finishing this book, and my odds were on the book at that point, but I did find it. So now we're gonna do something that's way more fun, which is I'm going to listen to this audiobook, And we're going to just see how many shiny Pokemon I can find in Scarlet and Violet. My goal with shiny hunting is I would like to have a living Dex where I have all, it's over 1,000 now, all the Pokemon in their shiny form. There are Pokemon that are shiny locked, and if anyone is interested in talking more about this, I can delve into it more in the comments. This is already going on way too long when I think more people are going to watch this video for the reading than the Pokemon. However, we're going to be reading The Diamond Eye by Kate Quinn, and so I should tell you about that book. This is based on a true story, and it is about Rye and bookish history student Mila Pavlichenko. Rye and bookish student Mila Pavlichenko organizes her life around her library job and her young son. But Hitler's invasion of Russia sends her on a different path. Given a rifle and sent to join the fight, Mila must transform herself from studious girl to deadly sniper, a lethal hunter of Nazis known as Lady Death. When news of her 300th kill makes her a national heroine, Mila is torn from the battlefields of the Eastern Front and sent to America on a goodwill tour. Still reeling from her war wounds, and devastated by loss, Mila finds herself isolated and lonely in the glittering world of Washington, D.C., until an unexpected friendship with First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt and an even more unexpected connection with a silent fellow sniper offer the possibility of happiness. But when an old enemy of Mila's past joins forces with a deadly new foe lurking in the shadows, Lady Death finds herself battling her own demons and an enemy bullets in the deadliest duel of her life. Based on a true story, The Diamond Eye is a haunting novel of heroism, of a mother who becomes a soldier, and a woman who found her place in the world and changed the course of history forever. And I believe the first time I read this description, I was hoping that Eleanor Roosevelt and her would have a little tryst on the side, because Eleanor Roosevelt was definitely gay. So yeah, I'm excited. I'm going to go ahead and get set up. And I think I'm more thinking out loud now, but I will probably just include the snippets of the shiny Pokemon, and I will just interject when I have updates on the book. And I will see you guys in a little bit. My hair is a mess. That's just what it is. But I am, how many chapters? I meant to be prepared. I think I'm like 4 chapters in. Okay, yeah, I have finished 4 chapters, which is about, if we round up, it's about an hour, and I've already found my first shiny. It was Chimchar. And that already makes me feel better after spending so long on that egg hunt. But the book, I actually have an update as well, which is kind of surprising. But I have read 2.5 Kate Quinn books previously. I love The Alice Network. It is one of my favorite historical books. Like, it was so good. And then we read, oh my gosh, what was it? The Rose Code. And I really enjoyed that, like, from a historical standpoint. I thought that part was really interesting. The romance of it and the individual characters didn't do a lot for me, but I still enjoyed the story overall. And then I started reading The Huntress earlier this month, and I cannot get into it. I haven't committed to DNFing it, but I did just kind of put it on pause for now because I just wasn't liking it. But I'm happy to say The Diamond Eye is really holding my attention, and I really like it. And something that I found really interesting is early on, I don't have the book near me, when, I keep wanting to call her Maria, and I'm pretty sure it's Mila, and it's going to be so hard for me to figure this out now. The book is too far away. Okay, fine. We'll just go on this computer that's right next to me. Okay, so when Mila is at the beach with her friends, and they find out that Germany has invaded Russia, and how she's reacting to that information and how she feels, all of that was giving me the weirdest, I guess, flashbacks to when I heard about the Twin Towers on September 11th. And obviously my reaction was quite a bit different than Mila's. I was 11 and I did not want to go join a war. But it was so interesting to kind of hear this perspective that I know is very true for all world events. You know, I know this experience is not unique to me, but I feel like a lot of these stories don't talk about kind of that initial moment of finding out that everything has changed. And what I really liked about that was it was such a normal day until it wasn't. And that just mirrored my September 11th day. And it's so interesting how much of my life kind of just, I don't remember, which is, you know, normal. You don't remember every single minute of every single day of your life. But I remember so much of September 11th, 2001. Like, it's probably one of my strongest memories of my childhood. And I grew up in Michigan. Like, I wasn't particularly physically close to 9/11, and I did not have family over there. I did not have family in the military. Like, there was not a lot that directly tied me to 9/11, but it was such a catastrophic, world-changing moment. And I, like, had to just kind of act like nothing was happening, because that was how the world, and by the world, I don't mean the world. I mean, my very small bubble. We just kind of were like, oh, well, there's nothing we can do about that, so we'll ignore it. It was very, very weird. That sounds way more callous than it actually was. They were not talking to us about 9/11. I was in middle school. They told the high school they were allowed to watch TV or watch the news. They were not telling middle schoolers, but cell phones did exist and people did find out. And normally we were allowed to go outside at recess. They did not let us outside, but they didn't tell us why. But because people knew, people had informed me. And for most of the day, I thought it was a history lesson because the people that informed me had just come from history class. So I was like, oh, like, that's our history lesson today. And then that never happened. And I kind of just let it go until the end of the school day, when the principal told us at the end of the day. They didn't want any of the students to worry, which obviously had the opposite effect, because people did find out and no one was allowed to talk about it. It was very odd. And then my friend, like, I think she was at the eye doctor that day, and then she had to come over. Well, she didn't have to. I wanted her to come over after school, and her eyes were dilated. And I don't know why I remember that fact, but I do. So all that to say, I'm enjoying the writing style. I'm enjoying the story. I am enjoying how Kate is kind of balancing that line of Russia as a country has its issues. Even, you know, going back to World War II, they had their issues, but that doesn't negate the help that they were providing during World War II. Like, both things can be true. And I like that she's not trying to make this a black and white issue, that it's all very gray. And I think it's very interesting, and I'm excited to see where this is going to go. And I'm more excited that this is actually based on a real woman. I want to know more about her, because these are not things. And I remember that with the Alice Network and the Rose Code, like, these were not things I was taught in school. So I like seeing more of what the women were doing during all of our wars. And I realize Kate Quinn definitely has a big focus on World War II, and I do typically enjoy that in my historical fiction. But in general, like, the women were doing more than we ever have given them credit for throughout history. And I like seeing these stories about that. Now we got to go back to the book and to the grind. I have a Chimchar outbreak, so I think I'm going to try for two more so I can have the whole line. But if I get bored of that, I'm just going to roam around Paldea and see what I find. So I found another shiny, and I made it to 25% of the book, and I have nerd gummy clusters. So all in all, it's been a pretty good evening. I found a shiny Squirtle, that I almost completely missed because it's not a super obvious shiny and I couldn't see its shell. But I got tired of resetting for the Chimchar, so I just kind of ran around and it was just there. I love when that happens. Something that I find really interesting is that at the beginning of, I don't think it's every chapter, but a handful of chapters, Mila opens with what was said in her official memoir and what her opinion of that statement really meant, so to speak. Like in chapter 8, she says, "My memoir, the official version, rank conveys privilege. And my memoir, the unofficial version, being known as someone who can put a bullet through a target's eye at 500 meters, also conveys privileges." Where it's clear that at least in this version of Mila's history, her memoir is sanitized. I have not done any personal research on Mila, so I don't know if there even is a real memoir about her. It does stand to reason that there would be at least biographies written about her just for being this incredible assassin during World War II. But right now she has just very recently gotten into her sniper position. She is not one for showboating. She does not want to brag about her kill count. She doesn't want to showboat. Like, she takes this as a job. She understands that killing people is a very personal thing to be doing, and it's not, she's not doing it to get a high number on a scoreboard. She's doing it to do her job and to do it well. And I really appreciate that. And I love that throughout all of this, we're getting glimpses of her talking to her family back home, in particular her son, and how she has agreed to be the mother and father to her son because her, well, I say ex-husband, they are legally still married because he's a douche canoe. He is not showing up, so she has promised her son, "I will be both your parents for you." And then, of course, she goes off to war. So you're seeing her try to be the perfect parent as well as be this perfect sniper. And I think that humanity in her is so interesting. And she's doing this incredibly difficult job. And then she still takes the time to go and collect local flora to send home to her son to teach him what it is, because he's in, I feel like it's basically Russian Boy Scouts, like the red, everything's red there, isn't it? What's important is they're studying like plant life and stuff. And so she obviously can't teach him in person. So she's doing the best she can from away. And I think that is just so touching. And now it's going to bother me. What are they called? They're called Young Pioneers, not red. Although I think he gets like a red kerchief or something. But I'm loving this and I'm so happy because I was really kind of apprehensive about starting this because of my kind of bad experience with the Huntress. And this is not it at all. This is so good. Timing is working out so well. I found a shiny Bisharp, whatever, it's blue. And I am almost 50% of the way through the book, which means I'm averaging, well, I've just really put myself on math here, but like one every five chapters. Let's put it that way. I don't know what that is in minutes right now, but it's kind of working out. So by that logic, I would get maybe 3 to 4 more shinies by the time I finish this book, which would be exciting. Though I am currently in a Bisharp outbreak and my odds of finding a second one fairly quickly are probably higher than if I just kind of ran around and looked for more. So we'll see. But at almost 50% what has been going on. Because I don't think I want this to be like a spoiler vlog, nothing crazy specific has happened. Mila's husband, Alexei, has come back into the picture. There has been a lot of talk about being a sniper in a war, what the issues might be for a woman in war. You know, a lot of sexism that she's dealing with, and one of her commanders explaining to her that despite the fact that she is, you know, she's a sniper, she's an amazing shot, she needs to keep a pistol on her because if she gets caught, she won't be killed. And that's worse, obviously. So, you know, there's a lot of kind of horrifying realities to that. Like, she would not be, I mean, I suppose she technically would be a prisoner of war, but you know what I mean? Like, they would be kidnapping her to do horrific things to her because she's a woman, not necessarily because she's a soldier. So, you know, there's a lot of those conversations. I haven't had a lot of the US side of things yet. Not the US's side of the war, but the book is told in a dual perspective or dual timeline, where in the beginning, or the one timeline is Mila, you know, like before the war, during the war, all of that. And then the second, we're just kind of getting interludes of her tour after the war, specifically coming to DC and meeting President Roosevelt and how that was received in America. And we're getting very small snippets. There is a group there who want Lady Death, aka Mila, to kill FDR. And, or maybe not even literally kill him, but the plan is for FDR to be assassinated and for Mila to take the fall for it. And so we're getting that perspective, and we're not getting a lot of that. It's every few chapters. And with that, we're getting Eleanor Roosevelt's journals talking about her relationship with Franklin and her eventual relationship with Mila, friendship relationship. I made a comment to my friend who read it about, it's been interesting to hear Eleanor's diaries. I haven't researched this, so I don't know if these are real diaries or just kind of interpretations, but there's a few comments of her talking about Franklin in a kind of romantic sense. And I was like, it's just kind of interesting to hear that, because ever since I heard that she was gay, that really tracks. And I watched the show First Ladies, and they kind of delved into that. And that all feels like, we'll never get like official confirmation, but it feels accurate. So it's interesting to hear someone kind of talk about Eleanor and Franklin having a consensually romantic relationship. Not that she's gone that far, but that's kind of how it feels. And my friend was saying that she kind of got more like sibling energy from those posts. But she also refers to the friendship of Mila and Eleanor. So sadly, they will not be gay lovers for me, which is disappointing. But I guess considering they are both real people, that is probably historically accurate, and I have to be okay with that. But all that being said, she has racked up about 200 kills, and I believe her grand total is 300. And given that we are at the halfway point, I am imagining maybe the second half of the story, or give or take, will be her tour in America, that friendship with Eleanor, and this plot to take down FDR. That may all be one, that may be the second half of the book almost entirely. I'm not sure. Just because those chapters were so short, and I feel like it's an integral part of the story. So I'm very curious to see where this is gonna go. And I'm curious to see what shinies I'm going to find. found a shiny scatterbug. And I have like 50 pages left, give or take. I'm on chapter 29, which is page 347 out of 418. So like what, 70 pages? Close enough, who cares? And things have been going crazy. And I did find out she does have an official biography. I did not double check if it was autobiography or just a biography. So I'm doubly curious now if all those headings of her official and unofficial, if the official is a direct quote. And I have to agree with my friend. I love the friendship between Eleanor and Mila. I think it is very wholesome and very realistic, which makes sense because it's probably based on actual facts. But one thing that I found really interesting was throughout all of these snippets we've been getting of, what are you doing, baby girl? Of this hitman. I forget what they call him. I remember Pocket Square, but that's not the guy I'm talking about. The guy Pocket Square talks about, he clearly, I mean, obviously he's out to kill FDR. So obviously he doesn't like the Roosevelts. But what I find really interesting is all of the negative things he has to say about Eleanor, just like in terms of her appearance, just strictly that. He's just constantly talking about her being horse-faced and being ugly and too chatty and just kind of all of this sexist, misogynistic, just bullshit. And then Mila and Eleanor are talking and Eleanor comments essentially about how you have to grow a thick skin if you're going to be in the public eye. And even though Mila did not ask to be in the public eye, it is advantageous to her to not let comments about her get under her skin. And I was like, oh, that's really interesting, because every single time this man was just like, I was like, you can hate Eleanor for many things. You're not allowed to hate her for having like a horsey mouth. And my God, all of these descriptions of Eleanor, I'm just like, does everyone hate her? She is my favorite first lady, or maybe not favorite, but she's up there. Partially because as a child and as an adult, the movie Annie is one of my favorite movies of all time. I'm obsessed. I love it. I love it so much. It's one of my favorite stage shows. So as a small child, I was very familiar with who the Roosevelts were. I was very aware of Eleanor Roosevelt. And granted, as a kid, I would always laugh because when they're at the White House and Annie is singing Tomorrow, and then of course they all join in and FDR looks at Eleanor and he's like, basically, like, you need to sing with us too. And she's like, I can't sing. And FDR's like, I don't give a shit, sing anyway. And so she starts singing and her voice, it's really not bad, but it's very obvious. Like, it doesn't blend in as well with the rest of the cast. So I would always laugh at that as a kid.
The sun'll come out tomorrow.
Saying Oliver, that's order from your commander-in-chief.
There'll be sun.
Eleanor?
I can't sing.
Sing.
Tomorrow, clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow.
So I am not immune to making fun of First Lady Eleanor. Another fun fact, we have the same birthday. So she's always been like a first lady that I've just adored. And I love the name Eleanor. It was my great grandmother's name. It's just everything about her I love. So it's been fun to read this and kind of get this history-ish of her in a whole setting that I've never heard of before. And with the final countdown finally coming, I'm skeptical but hopeful that I will find one more shiny Pokemon. I did find a shiny Tentacruel as well, but I had no book updates, so I just tossed that one up right now, I guess. So I'm at 5. I'm hoping to get one more before the book ends, but we'll see. I was not prepared for this. Okay. Hi. Hello. Welcome back. I finished the Diamond Eye, and I caught 7 Pokemon, which is math. I think that evens out to almost 1 every 2 hours, which is really kind of making me rethink how much I enjoy that as a hobby. But what's interesting is 3 of those 7 I found just running around fully randomly. They're not full odds because I have a shiny charm, but like as full odds as I'm ever going to get. And so that was really interesting. And then 3 of them were in an outbreak, which has boosted odds. And then the 4th one was, I put on a sandwich to find it. So it had like really good odds. Anyway, that was a fun experiment. I'm glad I did this. This was a fun way to break up my traditional reading, and I've been struggling with audiobooks lately. So it was a really good way for me to focus on an audiobook while also doing something that I enjoy. And for me, a lot of these were Pokemon that I didn't have their shiny form of yet. So it was all in all a win. And if you can't tell from the cadence in my voice, I really liked this. And also I guess all my updates. I gave it 4 stars, and I was just texting my sister how this really just solidified that Eleanor is one of my favorite first ladies. Like, I think it's like tied between her and Michelle Obama, honestly. They're 2 of my favorites, both in personality and projects that they worked on. And I know this book isn't about Eleanor, but her presence is there and it's felt, and I just enjoy her. And that's making me think I should probably maybe find like a biography on her, or if she has done an autobiography. That's for future me. All to say, we are following Mila, who starts life, not start, well, she starts her journey in this book acting as a single mom, although she is still legally married because her husband sucks. And she ends up deciding she's going to be both mother and father to her son because her husband sucks. And learns how to essentially be an amazing sharpshooter. And once World War II starts invading Germany, she signs up to be a sniper. And she has extreme success. And something really interesting about Russia that I did not know is they gave women a lot more freedom than a lot of other countries did for a long time. Or at least that's my kind of interpretation. Like, they were treated equally in the army, or, okay, let's not go that far. They were allowed to join the army or the military in a way that I think a lot of other countries were not allowing from the get-go, although obviously women did serve in the military because they were needed. Whereas Russia, it was like, you are just allowed to sign up. And I thought that was really interesting. And Mila goes on to say later in the book that, you know, Russia has a lot more freedoms for women than America has. And there's a kind of a level of disrespect for the way that the press was treating Mila, which is absolutely true. But as an American who grew up with press like that, it didn't shock me because that is the culture in which I'm used to. That does not condone the behavior of the invasive news media. Then now, throughout history, the media is absolutely vulturistic, and it's only gotten worse. There was a period of time where I feel like it got better because of social media. The celebrities could kind of control their own narrative, but they're horrible. Not all of them, obviously. All that to say, this was a win. I learned a lot, and I want to learn more, especially because I was saying earlier that that I never learned this stuff in school. I did not learn about a lot of women heroics. Like, you've kind of got, you know, like people like Mother Teresa, and I'm failing to remember anybody else. I don't know why that's the only name that came to mind, But we don't learn about a lot of women here. Or I didn't. I'm genuinely hoping in the past... God, how long has it been since I graduated high school? Oh God, it's been almost 20 years. Okay. Identity crisis. Yep. Okay. So I'm hoping a lot has changed and more women throughout history are getting recognized in school, but I didn't. But especially because if that attack on FDR was true, because I have not looked into if that part of the story is true or if it was fabricated for the novel. I did not finish the author's note yet. She may have discussed that. But, you know, if all of that was true, I can see why they would kind of downplay some of that. And I didn't know, assuming that that part is factual, that her tour in America was done to get us to join the war. My understanding, and again, this is based off of what I learned in school and what I read in this book. I have not done additional research. But my understanding was once Pearl Harbor happened, America joined the war. And there was not necessarily a distinction between were we fighting Japan, were we fighting Germany. My understanding was that Pearl Harbor happened and we joined the whole war. Obviously, there was an interest in going after Japan because of Pearl Harbor. But I was never taught a distinction between where we were fighting once that happened. It was just kind of like, we entered the war and then we helped. So to potentially learn, I really should be doing my research before talking, but I wanted to remember the book first. So to learn that it was entirely possible that we didn't join the war until Russia came and asked for our help in the way that this book describes is potentially very interesting. And now I have to go do a bunch of research about World War II again because I want to know how much of this was actually factual and how much of it was taking a real person and kind of making a fabricated story about her. All that to say, I enjoyed this. I definitely recommend this, especially if you like Kate Quinn. I think part of the reason I gave it 4 stars over 5 is twofold. One, I know Kate Quinn's gonna put a romance in there. I didn't personally need the amount of romance that we had. That doesn't make it bad. It just wasn't my personal choice. And then also, I think it was just like slightly too long. I don't know what I would have cut though, so I don't really know what I'm saying about that. And then quite interestingly, I just noticed this, there are a few pictures in the back. Oh, there she is with Eleanor Roosevelt. How precious. Okay, so 4 out of 5, definitely recommend. And 7 Shinies, also recommend. This was a fun project. And I will see you guys in another video in the future. Bye.